Good morning.
Good morning.
Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So, in today's gospel reading, there were three distinct ideas that jumped out at me and I wanted to explore with you today. And the first one is the epiphany of Christ. And the second one are the opposite reactions to this epiphany of Christ, this announcement of Christ by Herod and the Magi. And then the third one is the Magi's journey. They journey from the familiar to the unfamiliar and how we're changed. So let's talk about epiphany. So what the heck does epiphany mean? Ooh, and this is where I need my clicker. Okay. All right, so epiphany. This in Greek means the appearance or a revelation. So today we might call an epiphany an aha moment, or maybe even the big reveal. Okay, and so what is it that's being revealed? It's Christ, the gentle king, the king of all people. It's his birth that's being, his arrival here that's being announced. And another thing that I thought was really interesting is that this announcement of the king of the Jews comes from the Magi, who aren't Jews at all. They're Gentiles. During Jesus' lifetime, kings were considered divine. And I'll give you an example. The Roman emperor, Caesar Augustus, was considered a god with a small g. And with the birth of a king, there was a big to-do. You would expect state visits and really expensive gifts to be brought. And if it was a really important king, there just might be in the sky some sort of celestial announcement. And this is where the Magi come in. The Magi, or the wise men, were astrologers from the East. And that was their job, was to search the skies looking for information. And when they saw this star, they were really curious. What does this mean? And so they studied and they found in the Hebrew Bible a prophecy. Prophecy for a king. A king who would be for all people. And they were excited. They were really excited. They decided they needed to go and find this king and bring him great gifts and to worship him. But they weren't exactly sure where they were to go. They had this star they were going to follow, and they knew that he was going to be king of the Jews. And so Jerusalem is the place to head because that's the holy city of the Jews. So that's where they went. And I know all this sounds really exciting, but remember, there is some tension in today's gospel message. Not everyone that is going to encounter this epiphany of Christ is excited about it like the Magi are. And the Magi are going to go on this journey from the familiar to the very unfamiliar, and they'll be changed. So they get to the holy city and they head on over to Herod's palace and they ask directions. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is how that we know they really are wise men, because they stopped and asked for directions. So anyway, they get to Herod and they ask him this question: where is the one who is born king of the Jews? We saw his star rising and we've come to worship him. Well, this didn't sit really well with Herod, because Herod wasn't the king of the Jews. Herod wasn't a king at all. Herod wasn't even a Jew. And he was afraid. He was scared. He was frightened. I looked at some other versions of the Bible and came up with words like disturbed, deeply disturbed, even terrified. So there's something about this epiphany of Christ that was really terrifying to Herod, which is in stark contrast to the Magi. Herod's epiphany was going to lead him to a murderous rage, if you read a little further in the gospel lesson. So Herod also frightens all of Jerusalem with him. It's the temple rulers that he calls in and starts to grill. What do you know about this prophecy? What do you know about this king? Where is this king supposed to be? And so the temple rulers tell him, but they're afraid too. They know this prophecy comes from Micah. They know the Roman Empire who rules over them, and they certainly know Herod. Herod was a ruthless ruler who had absolutely no problem getting rid of anyone who got into his way. According to one of the sources that I researched, Herod had 10 wives and ordered multiple assassinations. And some of the people that he had assassinated were his own sons. And if this frightened the Magi, they didn't let it stop them. They went ahead and continued on their journey, bringing their wonderful gifts, following the star and heading to Bethlehem. And when the star stopped, they were overjoyed. They were overwhelmed with joy. That was their epiphany of Christ. That they came to worship a king, and yet he was so much more to these people who weren't even Jews. They had gone, these Magi had gone on a journey, a really dangerous one, far away from home to a foreign land, from the familiar to the unfamiliar, to the Roman Empire, which was the biggest, baddest nation there was, and ruled by people who didn't put up with problems, and also to a ruler like Herod, who was ruthless. I went on a similar journey from the familiar to the unfamiliar when I was 17. I thought it would be totally cool to be a foreign exchange student. I thought to myself, ooh, I get to travel internationally, and I'll live with a host family who'll take good care of me while I have a great time exploring their culture. And it'll look really good on any application I send to a college. And so I waited, and I found out that my family, my host family, was living in Malaysia. And I'm like, where is that? And so I had to get out my world map and look it up and find out that where Malaysia is. I'm from a small town in upstate New York, and Malaysia is about halfway around the world from there. And I had never, ever been on a plane before. And I was going to have three host sisters. I didn't have any sisters. I had absolutely no idea how that was going to go. And they eat really spicy food over there, and I had never had any spicy food. And my family practiced Islam. I didn't practice any religion. Everything was different. I mean, everything was different. And I was quite different, too, to them. And I was the endless source of good-natured mirth, because I was forever committing faux pas, doing all sorts of things wrong in their culture. And I'll give you some examples. So 45 years ago when I was there, the left hand was saved for a particular job. I'm left-handed. And young people didn't speak unless they were spoken to. And those of you who know me, oh my gosh, keeping my mouth shut? And you always give to beggars, because that's how they support themselves and their families. And when somebody from three lanes of traffic waves and shouts, "Orang putih, orang putih," which means white person, you were expected to smile and wave back. And anybody who met me and got to know me wanted to, "Can I touch your blonde hair? Can I touch your white skin? And the things that we consider to be personal questions here are definitely not considered to be personal questions in Malaysia. And my host sisters could always tell when I was getting to become, she's going to be rude, you know, because I had taken offense at something that really wasn't offensive. And so they'd walk over to me and put their arm around my waist and whisper in my ear, just smile. And so I did. And then later on, they would explain to me what had happened and why and how I should not have taken offense at that, because it really wasn't offensive. So you might wonder, did I like this journey? Because it was so really different. Matt, will you please advance a slide? My little clicker has gone off. Thank you. And so I went from the familiar to the unfamiliar, and it was one of the very best experiences of my entire life, because I was loved. I was so loved. And there's part of my family right there. And this people who took this Orang Putih into their home and into their heart with all my faux pas, they guided me. They helped me navigate through this time when I was in their culture. And they loved me, and they laughed at me, and they laughed with me. And I saw that love breaks down all kinds of barriers and builds strong and lasting relationships that are seasoned by grace. That was my epiphany, my aha moment, and I was changed forever. I went on this unfamiliar journey and received something that I didn't even know that I wanted. But now I do know, and I want it desperately. I loved these people so much that I didn't want to go home. When it came time for me to go home, I told my host sisters, I'm not packing my bags, and I'm not going, and I lay down on my bed, and I cried. And my host sisters had to pack my bags for me. I ended up having to leave all of my clothes behind because I had been given so many gifts. And Matt, will you move this one again, please? So a few years ago, Mark and I had the opportunity to go to Malaysia, and we met again with my host family. And now my sisters and my brothers have married and have children of their own, and some of their children have children. And they threw this really great party for us, and I felt that love kindled all over again. And yes, they're still telling funny stories about me. And so this journey that the Magi have taken, that I have taken, and I think that we are taking too, from the familiar to the unfamiliar, is happening right here at Peace. You know, we're trying to reimagine ourselves. We're trying to reimagine our church. We're trying to reimagine our mission. And we're doing it in the middle of a pandemic and political divides and a new pastor. That's a lot. It's really enough to scare anybody. And I hear people asking questions like, oh, when are we going to start Monday morning Bible studies again? And when will we start Wednesday nights again? And when are we going to have two services again? And I think that Jesus might answer this question the way he answered so many of those questions in the Gospels, by not answering it at all. He would ask a different question, a question where he'd rather have you be, and issue an invitation. And the question will be, won't you join me on this journey from the familiar to the unfamiliar? Because I've got things for you that you don't even know that you want. Amen.